folks, welcome back to another Throat Punch Lunch. Well, it is the end of the year, pretty much. This has been a great year. We've had a lot of great conventions, a lot of great games, met a lot of really cool people, had a lot of really neat experiences throughout the course of all of those different conventions, and we've gotten through another, 20 or some odd episodes of Throat Punch Lunch. So I want to thank you guys for coming back and taking a gander each and every time we are putting one of these guys up. I appreciate it. And I want to thank all my contributors, of course, for sticking to it. And, we've lost a few great contributors along the way, and I feel bad about that. But, that's kind of life. You know, people come and go, but the show must go on. So that's what we're pretty much doing here. I've got a great episode for you. This episode, I wasn't able to do any segments, and I do apologize for that because it feels kind of cheesy. It's my show. I should be able to crank out some segments. But I had jury duty the last couple of days, and we just got back from the cruise last Thursday, and so we were kind of recuperating from that on Friday, and it just didn't happen. I actually forgot. I probably would have recorded something on Friday had I remembered that I had jury duty this past week, Monday and Tuesday. But so I apologize. I don't have any segments, but you know what? After I've taken a look at the rest of the segments that are on there, any segment that I would have added to it probably would have lessened the episode's value. I've got a lot of tried and true contributors that are really starting to kick it up to the next level as far as the quality of their segments are concerned. They've always been good, in my opinion, but they just keep getting better is what I mean. And I've got a new Wargaming correspondent from England. Her name's Katie from Katie's Game Corner. So she's joining us this episode, and hopefully we'll continue on in the near in the distant future, rather. Koray, he used to do a segment on Star Wars games and like Imperial Assault and X-Wing and Destiny and all of these other kinds of games that are out there and how you can customize your decks. He's coming back now with a called a Print and Play 3D, where he is going to be showcasing different kinds of 3D printed things that he does for games, box inserts, models, and all this other kind of stuff. So I'm looking forward to his contributions as well. Ambie Valdés coming back with a new song. So there's just a lot of cool stuff. You're probably tired of hearing me ramble on. You've probably already clicked through, haven't you? You've skipped over all this. That's fine. I don't mind at all. Let's get to the rest of your lunch.
Let it grow on my games, on my friends rely. start with purchasing up each and every game. And I will keep them even if I think that they are lame. No need to research, I won't take the time to think. Won't even play them all, I'll keep them in the shrink.
Okay, guys, I'll see you later. Have fun. Don't get in too much trouble. Love you.
Well, Mommy's gone, so I guess it's just the two of us. What should we do? Wanna play around? We got a little Froggle Frump here, you know? It's a little monkey thing, little monkey rattle guy. Whatever this thing is, you know? I don't know. What do you think? What do I want to do? Well, I think we both know what I want to do. I want to play a game. Games. I wonder, I mean, you are my genetics and all. I mean, we share DNA, so, I mean, you know what? It's never too soon to start.
All right, Libs, let's get started with Hive. Hive's a fun one. Let's try this. That's not super hard, and there's cute little bugs on the pieces, but let's give it a shot here. You can be the white ones. There you go. And the black ones.
Okay. Your move. Copying my moves, I see. I learn fast.
Not bad.
Oh! You're picking this up pretty quickly, I see. Don't you think you're gonna win?
And then here you go, and you just won. Well, you just won the game. Your first game of Hive. 5-month-old just won.
Okay. There's no way you're gonna beat me at this one, Liberty. No way. Tiny epic galaxies!
That's right, we're gonna be doing some spaceship stuff.
Yeah, this one's gonna be a little too complex for you. But don't worry, Daddy will walk you through it, so.
Alright.
Okay, I'm gonna move a ship, gonna orbit there. Okay, well, that's the end, but I got my secret mission though. Let me check yours. Oh, got yours too. Well, I've still got 21 points, and you have, 30 points. You beat me again. Just a sorry, I just had something in my throat.
Yeah. Okay. Alright, well, I gotta let you go. I just got home. Alright. Okay. Love you, bye.
Well, that's it for this segment, guys. I hope you all enjoyed it. What'd you think, Libby?
me love me some board games.
That's my girl. Now, if you haven't already, please follow me on all those socials. I really appreciate all the support. And until next time, game on.
Print and Play 3D. My name's Koray, and this is going to be the only show on the internet where we're going to be using 3D printing technology and board gaming and blend them into one awesome world. So I'm going to be showing you lots of things over the course of these segments, but the first thing I want to show you is a 3D printed insert from Reverman on Thingiverse.com. Let's get it to the table, and I'll show you what it looks like. So let's take a look at the insert that I was able to print, and removing the box lid. The manual sits on top very nicely, along with the dig boards. They're all there. And we finally get to the 3D printed parts. So let's take a look at some of these decks. Now, granted, I only printed one of these. So this fits two different player decks. So here's the gray player and here's the orange player. And I could have printed one more of these, but instead I decided to bag them up to save on some plastic. So, still works, still really good. And then this one holds all the trophies. So here's the minors, and it also holds the majors. Really nice. And then this one's just a box filler. This is optional to print, but it fits nicely in the box, so I decided to keep it. Now this one's my favorite part. This has a nice lid, and this holds all the tokens. These are going to be all the different materials that you're going to be mining. So here's an $8 one, and on the flip side has the other components. This is a really cool part right here because it has this little lip right here for the skull tokens. And normally you're not supposed to know what side you're going to get. So this little lip right here prevents the players from looking at it. So you can just pull from here and look at it and be on your merry way. So it's pretty nice. And then the last component is the dig tiles. So these are the three dig tiles. It holds the three-piece one, the two-piece one, and the one-piece one. All nice and neat and fits really nicely. Again, also a really nice lid. So that's going to wrap up our quick look view at the Super Motherlode insert that I was able to print. Thank you so much, Reverman, for sharing these files with us. It made setup and cleanup life so much easier for me. The token lid holder is definitely my favorite part. It even has a lid, so it keeps everything nice and secure. If you guys want to find out more about Board Game Essentials and some of the other 3D printing stuff I do, head on over to youtube.com/boardgameessentials. And with that, I hope you guys enjoy the rest of your day. See ya!
Hey everybody, it's Jay, and it's time to talk about your flair. On 15 Pieces of Flair, I'm going to show you guys some ways to spruce up that game room. So some deduction games are some of my favorite game types. I always throw out the, that's something a traitor would say, or only a werewolf would do that. Well, the winner of my giveaway, Chaz Brown's favorite game, is Battlestar Galactica. So I figured I'd make him some great Battlestar Galactica flair that would make any Cylon nervous. Let's check out how I made it. For this project, we're going to need a piece of 1x10 wood pre-cut to about 12 inches, a tape measure, two small screws, some string, black, gold, silver, and red spray paint, a stencil cut from shelf liner, a rubber glove, picture hanging wire, paper, and masking tape. Take the wood and measure a couple inches in from each edge with the tape measure and insert the screws. Then attach the string and hang the wood from the string in a well-ventilated area. Spray paint the entirety of the wood, front, back, and the edges. Once that's dried quite a bit, you put on your rubber glove. Then spray quite a bit of gold onto the fingertips of the glove. Then using a flinging motion, splatter the gold over the canvas. Repeat the process until you have a desired amount of gold splatters. Let that dry completely. Then you can apply the stencil. As you can see, the shelf liner was quite difficult to remove from the transfer paper and didn't want to cling very well to the wood. Patiently, I worked my way through it. Well, not really patiently, but you guys don't need to know about that. After I got the transfer paper all off, I carefully replaced the stencil to where it should be. Again, you can see the shelf liner was not wanting to cooperate. Once I got the stencil where I wanted it, I used the masking tape to mask the edges. Once again, the shelf liner was quite difficult, but I still tried to make it work. Then, in a well-ventilated area, I spray the entire stencil with silver. You can see a couple times the stencil just blows right off with the spray paint, but I just replaced it and we made it work. Once that dried, I used paper and masking tape to cover the "That's something A" and "would say" words. For the A, I had to rip the masking tape to mask over it. Then I sprayed the Cylon in red. But not a complete coat, I wanted some of the silver to show through. Then I removed the entire stencil. Wow, that looks like garbage. I'm gonna redo that. To redo it, you use the exact same materials, but this time I will be using outdoor grade vinyl stencil. Let's go ahead and paint over that mess with black. Do the same gold splatter and let those dry totally. Then you can apply the vinyl stencil. Wow, that was so much easier. Spray that stencil silver again. Mask the "That's something A" and "would say" words again. Spray the Cylon the same way with the red again, letting some of the silver show through. Remove the stencils after it dries. Yeah, that looks so much better. Finally, you need to install the hanging wire by wrapping it around the screws. Boom! There you have it. A quick and easy way to add some flair to your game room. Now that shelf liner usually works pretty good for stencils and stuff, but sometimes the vinyl is actually the much better option, especially when you have a lot of words, a lot of lines and stuff. And that shelf liner, I think, stretched out a little bit when I was trying to peel it off. But if you guys have any questions for me or if you like what I'm doing, go check out my Facebook page, Pique Your Interest. And if you guys need any supplies or help with any projects you're doing, that'd be a great place to get a hold of me. And I'd actually love to help. But if you guys have any suggestions on games or ideas you'd like me to make into some flair, just leave them in the comments below or go to my Facebook page, Pique Your Interest, or any other social media handle at Half Handicapped. But don't forget, 15 pieces of flair is the bare minimum. Some people choose to do more, and we encourage that. Have fun, everybody.
Hey, gamers. This is Liz Davidson with Beyond Solitaire, and I'm here to bring you another episode of SoloThrash, Amerithrash gaming for those of us who like to play alone. Are you a gamer who is solo curious? Perhaps you've been playing board games for a long time, but you've never actually played one by yourself, and you're not sure where to start. Well, today, I'm planning to help you, hopefully without you having to even spend any extra money on the adventure. In fact, Did you know that out of the BGG Top 100 list, 37 of those games come with official solo variants? You probably already own one of those games, which means it would be so easy to just pull one off the shelf and try it solo. I promise, you'll never go back. You're especially in luck if you happen to like Euro games. There's several Uwe Rosenberg games in the BGG Top 100, including Agricola, Caverna, and Ora et Labora. And Lav. He's a pretty popular game designer. There are also several other Euros that work really, really well solo, such as Viticulture, which comes with an Automa deck, so you're actually playing against a virtual player instead of trying to just beat your own top score. And an even more advanced version of that comes with Scythe. In fact, some players have reported enjoying playing with multiple Automa decks to simulate more than one fake opponent in a solo game. We also can't forget Terraforming Mars, which has really hit it big both with solo and non-solo gamers this year. But trust me, you're gonna like the solo version. Those of you who love Ameritrash, however, also have plenty of options. In fact, the current number two game on BGG's Top 100 is Gloomhaven, a game that the Dice Tower's Tom Vassell has said that is even better when you play it by yourself. There's also excellent options such as Mansions of Madness and Descent, especially if you're willing to play with an app. Star Realms has a special place in my heart, both as a game for two and as a game for one, and I'm really excited because with the release of Star Realms Frontiers, we're going to get even more solo scenarios. The Seventh Continent, one of the most unique games released recently, is also playable solo, and why let other people choose your adventure when you can choose it yourself? And you know all those longer co-op experiences that you just never seem to find other people to play with you? Well, if you take control of two or really more investigators, you can enjoy Eldritch Horror all by yourself. And if you're really feeling daring, well, why let anyone criticize you for being an alpha player? You can alpha all you want and play Pandemic, or even Pandemic Legacy, by yourself. That way, you can follow the whole story at your own pace and do it your way, which, trust me, has its charms. So if you've never gone solo before and you're thinking about giving it a try, I guarantee you, odds are that you already have a perfectly good option sitting right there on your game shelf, waiting for you to take it on a new adventure.
Hey everyone, this is Tim Jennette, the Metal Meeple, and this is the Budget Card Game Breakdown. So if you're a fan of small and cute card games, I have one for you this episode. This is Battle Kittens by Ultra Pro. In Battle Kittens, players are basically going to draft cats, and they're going to fight over these different battlegrounds to get fish tokens. At the end of the game, whoever has the most fish tokens is the winner. Each round, and you're going to play three rounds, is going to consist of placing three different battlegrounds. Two of them are face up, one's face down. And each, there's four different stats to the cats, and they're assigned randomly at the beginning of each round. One of them, for the random battleground that's face down, is also face down. So you can see here there's a big cat deck, and in this deck are different cats, obviously, and they have different stats. There's four different stats for each cat, and that's what you're going to be drafting for. So you know that this battleground's fought over strength. There's also agility, wisdom, and cuteness. Now, we don't know one of the stats, so you're kind of blind drafting against that. Either way, you're going to get seven of these cats. You're going to choose one, pass them until all seven have been drafted. The only other thing on the cards possibly is a special ability, such as this one, which will break ties. This one will draw another cat from the deck and place it into the squad once he's revealed. This one will draw a special ability card called a king card. And this one and some of the other ones will have flags, and they simply get extra bonus strength for having other colored cats there. So this guy will get extra points for having other blue cats at the same battle. Anyway, once you have your seven cats, we're not really going to draft them, we're just going to take seven here randomly. You're going to look at your cats and you're going to assign them to these three battlefields in front of you, not actually right there. We would look and maybe you assigned these two here, you know, these two here or whatever. Once that is done, everyone's going to fight over the first battlefield first. So you say, everybody grab the pile that you basically assigned to this one. And then everybody would flip their deck over, their squad, and they would count up how many points. So this is strength. This team would have 3, 4, 5. And let's say the next player had three cards, and he revealed, and he has 1, 2, 3, 4, This guy is a blue flag, but he has no other blue cats. And then this is Break Ties. Sometimes they're going to have the little crown icon in which you're going to draw from these this king deck. And they basically give you special abilities. You can see here that remove all but this kitten from the squad. So there are a couple of detrimental cards in here. Otherwise, it's going to be like plus one to stats or gain one fish, etc. There's not that many, but there's enough. And then lastly, if there's a ball of yarn, you're simply going to draw one from the top deck and flip it out. You also get to do all its special abilities down here as well. And that's pretty much the game. Once you count up whoever has the most strength at a site, they'll get first place. You know, so you would get three fish tokens, and they come in ones and fives. You would get three, the second player would get two, and then one. This game does play up to six players, so, you know, the more players you get, the less people are going to score, possibly. Sometimes, you know, you may want to be in second place because first place isn't as good, etc. I did forget to mention that once you get your guys from the draft, you do reveal this one before you actually assign your guys. So you get to at least know what this one is before you make your squads. Anyway, that's pretty much Battle Kittens. I kind of rushed through the gameplay here, but it's fairly simple. You just draft, assign guys to battlefields, and fight over them. It's pretty simple. If you're a fan of Smash Up, I don't necessarily think this is going to replace it or anything. However, it is a lot simpler than Smash Up, which is saying a lot. Most of the special abilities are only included in those king cards. Otherwise, you're simply drafting for numbers. So I think it can appeal to a lot of people if you don't want to deal with the comboing and things like that. You're simply like, here you go. You need these two stats. The last one's random. Draft how you will. So I think it's a pretty cool game, and the people I've played it with so far have actually been more impressed with it than I expected. So it's fairly light, really light. There's almost no actual player interaction. Even those king cards, there's nothing that really affects other players. It just affects you. So you know, if you got a family or something like that doesn't like to interact with each other so much, other than, you know, just trying to fight over a place. But I mean, you can't really mess anyone up, kind of deal. So anyway, I thought it was a fun game. It's very simple, it's very small, and the price point's pretty amazing for it. So check it out, if you will. It's made by Ultra Pro. It's called Battle Kittens. If you have any questions, post below. Do you like these type of games? How do you like the artwork? I thought it was pretty cool. So anyway, this is Tim. If you feel like emailing me, it's timjeanette@gmail.com. Follow me on social media at the handle below. Check out my podcast, MeepleCore. And until next time, keep on rocking and rolling dice.
Hello, we're Board Game Opinions. My name's Jonathan Hicks.
I'm Steve Rain.
And I'm Mark Windsor.
And today it's our designer spotlight, and we're looking at Antoine Bauza, I think is how you pronounce his name, French designer. He's one of my favourites, actually. I really like him. He's done a wide variety of games. Yeah. Seven Wonders is probably his most famous game. I like him, though, I don't know about you guys, because the games don't tend to be too heavy or complex, but they often give you a lot to think about. They're really involving, I find.
I think they're mechanically very simple in terms of what you do in some ones, you pick a card and whatnot, but the strategy and the depth in the games leads you to many, many replays.
Yeah, but he's now a lot of family games, certainly those two in particular, but I think your families could play Seven Wonders, I think, with a little, if they've played a few games before. He just does that really good weight and really well.
I've certainly played Seven Wonders a lot with my family.
Yeah, but it's not just families as well, because they're deep enough that anyone can play and not feel like they're kids' games.
Should we talk about Seven Wonders?
Yeah, I mean, Seven Wonders being his, they say, his most well-known game, the first winner of the Kennis Builder Jaris. Well, it's like a civilization drafting game. But I mean, I think of the games that we've played as a group, I think this is the one that gets picked out the most often. In a strange, if you look over the years, I think it's because it plays seven players well, because it's fairly quick. The amount of players doesn't make a huge amount of difference to the speed of the game. And I think everyone likes the theme. You're building up a tableau, you're adding technologies, you're adding buildings. Everybody likes that feeling. You end with a nice sort of civilization and you'll score loads of points.
There's a bit of interactivity, isn't there? You're sort of influencing your neighbours, but not too much that you're going to get beaten down by everybody
at
the table. This is Takenoko then, which looks sort of very chintzy, I suppose, from a bit cutesy. But although it is really a family weight game, you could also play this with gamers. There's a lot more to it than you might expect. There's a nice kind of colorful board with lots of sort of shoots of bamboo that are growing up, and the cute panda runs around eating it, and essentially you're trying to complete mission cards. But I've had a huge amount of success playing this with my family. My son loves this game, but also with other gamers who still enjoy it. That's one of the great things I think Antoine Bauza does so well.
Again, it's easy to get into. You've got, like, you roll the dice, it gives you an action to do, and then you can take two more. And you're just trying to do things as efficiently as possible, trying to complete as many goals as you can.
There's all the little extra things just to take it beyond just being a dull, I know what I'm doing straight away. There are choices to be made, and I think that's the important thing that makes it more fun.
There's interaction as well. You might, I need to grow this four high, but someone else comes on
and eats
it.
Don't move the panda.
Or move the gardener and makes it too high. A lot of the time I find I'm thinking about, can I put the panda somewhere so it can't get to the bamboo shoot I really need for this objective? So there's a lot to think about. It's good. The final game is Hanabi. It's one of mine and Jonathan's favourite ever games. Hanabi won the Spiel des Jahres in 2013. And at heart, it's a memory game. Effectively, you are trying to cooperatively build these fireworks together by playing a card from your hand in the right order. So you need to play the one, then the two, then the three of each colour. You can't see your own card, so you need help from other people. But the information they can give you is very restricted. They can only tell you specific numbers or specific colours. So if you've got a red one, they can't just say that's a red one. They can say that one and this one are ones, and then you still don't know. So it's very restrictive, but it's also got a lot of depth to it. Hanabi is my all-time favourite game, which surprises me because most of the games, certainly in my top 10, are much heavier games. I love Hanabi. I think it's the deduction aspect of it. You're kind of giving a clue, and it's like, will they understand that this actually means this when you say it? There's a kind of hidden meaning a lot of the time in the clues you give. And I love that extra layer that it adds.
And that's like the pick up and replay. You fail and straight away, let's give it another go. Because it doesn't take very long.
Yeah,
and you have that drive amongst families to, no, we want to beat this. I want to get a better score. And then next time, we brought Hanabi with you because we want to do better than we did last time.
Yeah. All right, well, thanks very much for watching. That was our designer spotlight on Antoine Bauza. Bye.
See ya.
I'm Katie from Katie's Game Corner, and you might know me for my love of war games. Have you ever wanted to play a war game but you just don't know where to start? Or maybe you like the idea of a war style game but you don't want to jump in right at the deep end? I thought what I'd do today is go through some of my favourite war games for beginners with you. First on the list is one of my favourite war games that GMT have produced, and it's one of the first hex and counter games that I actually learned how to play. Commands and Colours Ancient is a two-player game, and I feel like it's a perfect introductory game into the war game genre. Commands and Colours Ancients depicts warfare from the dawn of military history to the opening of the Middle Ages. It's quite an ambitious undertaking for one game, yet Commands and Colours by design is a unique historical game system which allows you to effectively portray stylized battles from this time in history, combining hand management along with dice rolling and a lot of strategy. I feel like Commands and Colours Ancients is a great war game for new people to the hobby or people that have been playing war games for years and years and years. Next on my list is Battle for Stalingrad. All you get in the box is some cards and counters, and it's pretty simple to learn, but it can be pretty difficult to master. So I feel like this is a great introductory one if you want to get into the theme of war games and start learning a little bit about history. The Battle for Stalingrad lasted 200 days from July 17th, 1942 to February the 2nd, 1943. Hitler himself had ordered the capture of the key Soviet city, and his armies were determined to carry out his orders. The game unfolds, you'll see one section of the city after another ground into rubble by your ceaseless fighting. As the city deteriorates, the amount of supplies generated for your men decreases. Supplies are the lifeblood of your army. Without them, you cannot move or attack, and you'll suffer high casualties in combat. The Battle of Stalingrad combines an abstract game with that war game feel, and like I said, it's so accessible, and it's nice to see a war game in a card game form. And last but certainly not least is Mark H. Walker's 65 from Flying Pig Games. A squad level tactical game, 65 recounts the early battles of the Vietnam War, from the Drang to Operation Starlight and most everything between. As these units' commander, you will move and fight over three geomorphic game boards as you try to best your opponent in one of eight nail-biting historical scenarios. This game is card-driven and using a system similar to Flying Pig Games and a lot of GMT games, which adds a sense of delicious uncertainty to the play. Furthermore, the cards simplify the game, containing much of the data needed to play, so you won't have to know all of those rules off by heart. It's one of those games that you will learn the more you play, but it's a great look into the war game genre and the war game system. And it's a perfect introductory hex and counter game for beginners. So there you have it, a few recommendations for some beginner war games. There's so many to choose from, but there's just a few that I enjoyed when I first discovered war games and the wargaming hobby. Have fun with it. Find a historical period or war that you're interested in or that you want to learn more about, and just discover what games are in that genre. And I hope this helped, and I hope you can play some of the games, and thank you for watching. See you next time.
What's going on, everyone? It's Roy Cannaday from Epic Gaming Night, and this is Why It's There, where I'm going to be taking a look at games in my collection and why I have it still on my shelf. So I go through a lot of different board games, and I have a pretty big collection, but I don't like to like make it expand too big or too huge, and I'm always getting rid of games that I don't continue to play. So today we're going to be taking a look at a game that's in my collection that fits that area control but like worker placement with dice games, and that is Alien Frontiers. This is a game that really started the like Kickstarter craze. This is one of the very first board games that was ever out on Kickstarter, and it has that whole area control of trying to take over the planet, but the main thing in this game is the dice. You're going to be rolling dice and trying to get different combinations of numbers. You can be like getting pairs to try to get more dice, which these dice are your workers and your ships, where you're rolling them to try to get all the different sets. You can get random whatever and be able to go to the hub and try to get your colonies down the board. And then once you get these colonies down the board, you're going to be able to get different special abilities for controlling different areas. If you have one of your guys in there and nobody else is in there, or you have the most in there, you'll get 2 points, and then you'll get a point for each different area that you're in. So you're like constantly fighting with the other players over the different areas to try to get different special abilities. Some special abilities like help you out in different ways. One will get you the like cool, like clear relic ship will give you an extra die to roll, and some give you like discounts on some of the other areas of the board to help you get artifacts better and utilize those better to get more solar energy so you'll have more resources. This game is great production quality from Clever Mojo. I remember when I first saw this game, I actually saw a review from Tom, saw it on there, and I'm like, man, that game looks great, I'd really like to get it. But it's from Game Salute, and it's really hard to find games from those guys online, so I'd really been looking for it everywhere, and we don't have a whole lot of local game stores, or at least not back in the day, around that would be able to get games like Alien Frontiers for a game store. And I actually had one of my friends buy this for me for a Christmas gift, like probably like 5 years ago, and it was super exciting to be able to actually get a hold of Alien Frontiers, and I've really enjoyed playing with it. And I've had this game for a really long time, and it's still a game that I love to get to the table. It's just fun doing that area control, racing on the points, trying to get all your colonies down. You can lengthen and shorten the game by how many colonies you play with. It's a ton of fun. There's several expansions with asteroids and the different factions where you can give different special powers to each player. So it's a whole lot of fun. Alien Frontiers is a game that's gonna stay in my collection just because it's a solid dice placement game, and it's one of the best games out there if you're into that like family weightish Euro style game. And that's the kind of Euro games that I like, with the awesome area control, and space theme is always great too. So, Alien Frontiers, you get to stay on my shelf and you're amazing. So until next time, I'll see you then.
Hey everybody, Even Steven here. Christmas time is upon us, and I know a lot of you are looking for gifts to give to gamers. I'm here today to give you some tips I have, which, believe it or not, is not to buy them a game. Let me show you. The first idea to get gamers is to get them something that can hold their games. This may seem like a simple idea, but a lot of gamers just use plastic bags and carry them by hand. You can get this ChromaCast bag on Amazon that holds a lot of Squarebox games. Maybe they already have a game, like Codenames, but you really need a nice plastic case to put the cards in. Or even an IKEA bag can hold even games side by side, and you can pack a lot in these, and these will make transporting games for your gamers that much easier. Next idea I have for gamers is to get them a playmat to play on while they are playing their games. You could get them a large playmat that can maybe go across the whole table. You could get a card mat to just pick up cards from during games, makes it a lot easier. Or you could get a playmat specifically for a certain game, like the Century Spice Road playmat. If maybe they enjoy that game, this will help enhance it for something you already know that they enjoy. Speaking of already things they enjoy, another good gift for a gamer would be seek out a promo, which you could look up on BoardGameGeek or online. For a game they already enjoy, you could get them another enhancement that and really could give variety to the game, and also is a cool thing to own that not a lot of people have. A neat add-on to get for gamers would be a starting player token. For certain games that they might enjoy, you might be able to come up with something rather than just a disc or token that is provided with the actual game. For instance, you could get a little rocket ship for the starting player in Terraforming Mars, or maybe a caveman chief for the game Stone Age. Another gift idea I have for gamers is to organize the inside of the box for their game for them. For example, you could get a box organizer from Broken Token, which is wooden that you actually put together that helps tear down and set up for a game for gamers, which time is precious. Also, you could get a foam insert that just fits in the box and stays there that holds all the pieces nice and neat for them. Another unique gift for gamers that's outside the box could be a Lazy Susan for certain card games. For example, in Clank, it's hard to read the cards when you're not facing the board, so the Lazy Susan allows whatever player's turn it is to face the board so that they'll be able to see. Another gift idea for gamers outside of the box would be a card rack, which can actually hold cards during gameplay that normally gamers would have to hold in their hands. This can make it a lot easier for games to play and more enjoyable for everyone involved. Another gift idea I have is the dice tray, in which it allows gamers to roll their dice in the tray rather than all over the table so they have to chase them. Another gift idea would be to personalize a player's playing pieces. For example, if a player did not have red available in a game, maybe buy them cubes or meeples in certain colors so that they could play in their favorite color. The last gift idea I have for gamers is to upgrade their resources and or the currency in the game. These allow for the resources to be very 3D and not just wooden, and they have a good weight to them depending on what you get. And also you could get metal coins to really make the gameplay more tactile than ever before. Okay guys, those are all the tips I have for gift giving this year during the Christmas season. Hopefully that helped you. Let me know in the comments if you have any other gift ideas that you could give to hopefully people who are trying to buy for gamers this year. We'll see you next time.
Hope you're enjoying Throat Punch Lunch this week. I'm Luke Hector, and this is the starting tile courtesy of the Broken Meeple, your first point of call for checking out new and interesting gateway games to introduce your friends to the hobby. Now, last week I took a theme that was somewhat hard to sell a lot to people, I'll admit, Dream Home. Well, this one, you should have no trouble getting into this theme, because who doesn't like cycling? It's... going to take that remote away from you if you do that again. This is Flamme Rouge, as I'm going to call it. I don't know if that's the proper pronunciation, but oh well, assuming. But this is an interesting cycling racing game. And I'm going to admit, it's not for everybody. You know, some people are not going to necessarily care about the theme, or they might want a racing game that's a bit more fun, frantic, and sort of in your face, hitting each other, that kind of thing. This one is more of a tactical card play racing game. You have two cyclists, and each of your opponents will, and your objective is simple, get across the finish line. But only one of your cyclists has to do it, because the idea is that one generally supports the other as they go through this track of going up and down hills, and, you know, alongside everybody else as a group. It's dirt simple, though. You have a hand of cards, two decks of cards, one for each cyclist, draw four cards from each deck, and this is all simultaneous. You look at them, pick one, rest go at the bottom in any order you like, and then you flip them over, resolve the movement based on who's at the front and who's at the back, and then you apply slipstream and exhaustion, rinse, repeat, keep going until someone wins. Slipstream is where you get behind another cyclist, so if there's a cyclist and you get there, you get bonus movement, you know, to get up behind him because you're basically, he's taking up all the air resistance and you're going behind him. You know, science! But you also have exhaustion, where if you're directly at the front and there's no one in front of you, you're taking all the air resistance, you're taking all the elements, and you're basically slowly getting tired out as your deck starts filling up with these very low speed cards. The two riders have got different distributions of the numbers of speed, you know, speed numbers in them. And, you know, you need to get exhausted at some point because your deck might not last enough, you know, long enough in the game to where at the very end you run out of cards and you're forced to just use those rubbish exhausted ones. So you have to chop and change between front and back as often as you can. It's, you know, great tactics, you know, you have to time your move with other players. It's super quick, the turns are lightning fast because a lot of it is simultaneous. And yeah, it's not like, hey, I beat you and stuff like that. But you get some great moments of, you know, when you do the best timing for slipstream, that tension of, oh, I'm going, you're neck and neck, and then get, and then when do you decide to break away from the pack and somebody else is there and then there's two of you at the front, who's going to get across the finish line first? It's a solid cycling racing game. And I admit, not for everyone, but it looks great, isn't too expensive, you know, the components are decent enough, and it works. For a cycling racing game, I didn't think I would enjoy it that much, but seems that it actually did better for me than I thought. So, cycling can work as a game. If you like the sport, if you want a racing game that is super simple, anybody could play this, kids easily, no problem, then definitely check out Flamme Rouge. Games will wrap up in less than 60 minutes, if that, and there's multiple ways to lay out the track. You can even build your own. It's a great system. Flamme Rouge, solid cycling racing game. Not for everyone, I admit, but worth a try if you're interested in that setting. So, that's it for me on this week's Starting Tile. Hope you've enjoyed Throat Punch Lunch. And remember, cycling, whatever racing theme you're into, still only a game. Just play it and enjoy yourselves. See you next time, guys. Take care.
So that's it for another episode of Throat Punch Lunch. Might be the last one of the year. I don't know. We'll have to see. I think I might have one more coming up towards the end of the year, but that might conflict with the holidays and all that kind of stuff, Christmas and New Year's. So I don't know if I'm going to do that. I'm going to have to talk to Tom about it anyway. So we'll see what happens. But if it is the last one of the year, I want to thank everybody for being a watcher, a listener, whatever you might be. And I want to thank all of my contributors in the past, present, and future for just doing a great job and making Throat Punch Lunch a reality. Without you guys, it would not be a reality. So I want to do, I want to really thank you, my contributors, for doing that. I can't thank you enough, really, because it's it really is a labor of love, and I appreciate that. And of course, listeners and watchers, you guys are important as well, because if you guys don't come and watch, there's no reason to put the show out. So I appreciate you guys coming in and taking a look at what we put out for you. Hope you continue to enjoy it. I know I do. So we'll see you guys on the flip side.
Thanks so much for watching the Dice Tower videos. Find more great videos and reviews, as well as our top-rated audio podcast at Dicetower.com. You can also find other great shows at Dicetowernetwork.com. I'm Eric Summerer, and you've been watching The Dice Tower. The Dice Tower is sponsored by Cool Stuff, Inc., where you can find great games for great prices. Cool stuff in stock. Check them out at CoolStuffInc.com.